I'm here today speaking with Becky Williams, who's an occupational therapist at Mercy Medical Center here in Canton, Ohio. She works in the low vision department, and I'm just going to let her tell us a little bit about what low vision actually is.
Okay, thank you for having me. Low vision is actually defined as a loss of vision that is severe enough to hinder the performance of activities of daily living, but still allow some useful visual discrimination. So it's important to note that the person is not completely blind, which means no light perception, but that their vision, for a variety of reasons, has been affected, and it does affect their daily participation, whether it's writing a check, reading directions to a recipe, reading the newspaper, being able to navigate within their home safely or out in the community, being able to discriminate depth perception or know when there is a curb cut or a step up. All of those things can be affected if an individual has low vision.
Okay, so it's not only a question of being able to perform their daily activities, but also a safety issue as well.
Absolutely. For a lot of our patients, if they live alone, when our program is set up to provide services for the elderly, frequently they are having no one to really be a second pair of eyes. So for example, being able to use a knife safely and cut a food item, being able to discriminate if a food item is spoiled or the date is expired, even being able to safely manage their finances so that they're not being taken advantage of. So the mobility is a big issue as well. With a lot of the low vision, you know, within the home setting, but also out in the community, they can be at increased risk for falls, you know, running into obstacles, items, objects, those sorts of things.
What are some of the diseases that might cause a low vision problem?
Well, it actually, statistics have shown that 76% of the low vision diagnoses are made up of three primary ones. There's macular degeneration, and there's a wet form and also a dry form. There is glaucoma and diabetic retinopathy. And with the macular degeneration, that will affect the center part of a person's vision. And we rely on that for being able to discriminate and identify faces, being able to read and write. And so frequently I will tell my patients and family members, so they have a better understanding as to what that individual is going through, if you would take your fist and put it up on the bridge of your nose and then look across to the person from you, that will demonstrate central visual field loss. Or do the same thing and try to read the newspaper. It becomes very difficult.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And frequently family members will say, well, I think, referring to the patient, I think they can see better than what they actually can. And so I use that as an example, and I tell them that, you know, they still have usable vision. And with macular degeneration, you never lose the peripheral vision, but it affects the center part of the vision, and it makes doing, like I said, those things very difficult and challenging. The other diagnosis is glaucoma, and there's actually over 100 different types of glaucoma, and glaucoma is an eye disease that affects the optic nerve, and so frequently with that, our individuals will have also additional what we call visual field loss in the outer periphery. And we rely on that for mobility. So obviously, if you lose your visual field, that makes it difficult for navigating around areas especially that are not familiar, such as a grocery store, a bank, those sorts of things. And then with the diabetic retinopathy, that is affected by diabetes. And it is a term that I use, kind of Swiss cheesy. It will affect a person's vision, and it makes it kind of mottled or distorted, plus the acuity is also affected as well. So with the diabetic retinopathy, it's really critical that the person is able to measure their blood sugars, able to measure and administer their medications correctly, I mean, those sorts of things are critical with managing your blood sugar and to stave off additional problems that diabetes can cause for the retinopathy.
Well, I know in occupational therapy, one of the main things that we focus on is a person's functional independence. Is it really feasible for somebody with low vision to be able to live alone?
Yes, absolutely. And it's using, you know, modifications, and it's using strategies, adaptive techniques, adaptive equipment that will allow a person to use the remaining vision as efficiently as possible. And a lot of times my patients are not aware of what's out there. Some of the modifications can be simple things such as adding additional lighting, task lighting, so the person can see things a little bit sharper and clearer for near distance, whether it's reading or writing. Some of the other adaptive techniques are using the magnifiers or talking devices or the closed circuit TVs that will actually enlarge print for reading and writing. So there's a variety of things that can be offered and done. And I frequently have had patients tell me, "You have given me hope. You have shown me that I am able to live with this and given me confidence." And that, to me, is so rewarding to hear. You know, but frequently our patients are left to believe when they leave the doctor's office that this is it. There's nothing that can be done until they get hooked up with the services, whether through our program or another program.
Well, and I imagine some of the things, you know, like the magnifier, you know, programs and stuff, some of that could be quite costly, mm-hmm. but do you have techniques that, yeah. that you've come across that are like quick and easy and very inexpensive?
Right, and it just depends on what the person's needs are and their current skill level and ability to use the remaining vision. For example, simple modifications could be if a person has impaired ability to discriminate contrast, such as pulling their clothes out of the dryer and matching their socks. A lot of times they'll put blues and browns and blacks all together. There's actually a gadget called a sock clip where you clip the sock together, goes through the wash, through the dryer, comes back out to the drawer. You know, marking clothes with like a brass pin on the label, that's a way of tactilely discriminating the clothing. So you're not mixing up a pair of navy slacks with a pair of brown slacks. You know, another example within the home environment is just for, you know, adding contrast. A lot of times my patients will say, "I keep bumping into that chair." You know, if you take a look at it, you notice the carpeting is brown, the lighting might be limited, the piece of furniture is brown. So we'll just take a doily and put it over the armrest, and that increases the contrast and the visibility to be able to then navigate around that chair. So there are a lot of things that can be offered and done that don't necessarily require a lot of money.
It seems like, especially working in the kitchen with knives, you know, that could, you know, could be pretty dangerous. What kind of things can you do to increase the contrast in the kitchen?
You know, some simple things that we'll do is we'll bring out under counter strip lighting, and that will increase the illumination onto the counter itself. There is actually, and we'll I'll show you in a little bit, a cutting board. One side is black, the other side is white. So if you're cutting like a tomato, for example, and you put it on the white side, that gives you a background contrast. So when you go to slice through the tomato, you're able to see what you're doing easier. Another example would be, you know, marking things in the kitchen as well. You know, using large numbered teaspoons, large numbered, you know, measuring cups. You know, there's sometimes even marking the dial on the oven with a contrast mark so that you can see the 350, or even marking the microwave so that you can see the buttons easier. So there's a variety of things that can be done in the kitchen.
Well, tell me how you go about doing this. Does a person come in here to the therapy room for this therapy, or?
We actually, this is an outpatient therapy service, but we go to the patient's home. They do not come to us. We set the program up that way because it allows us to look at the person's own home environment, you know, the available lighting that they have, glare issues, contrast issues, excessive use of even patterns, like if there's a lot of clutter, that makes using your remaining vision more challenging and difficult. Plus, it allows us to see how the person's actually functioning within that environment. You know, a lot of times losing your vision, my patients will describe to me, it's very scary. And so when I ask them, can you pour a cup of coffee? Can you cook something on the stove? They'll be like, I'm okay with that. But then when I actually have them do it or show me, I can then show them an easier way or a safer way of doing those activities with using a variety of strategies to allow them to be, you know, more independent or safer.
So. That's so exciting to actually go into their home environment, because mm-hmm. that's where real life is lived. It's
right.
not here under the bright lights of the therapy room. So
exactly.
I'm glad that you're able to do that. How is this all paid for?
Medicare, over a decade ago, recognized low vision as a medical diagnosis. And because of that, they approved occupational therapy to provide services for low vision and to reimburse for that. Other insurances tend to fall into line with what Medicare guidelines are. So because it is a recognized diagnosis, we've not had any difficulty with reimbursement.
Okay. Well, Becky, thanks for talking with me. And I think we'll head off into the kitchen right now, and maybe you can show us some different adaptive equipment.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Thank you.